Thank you. Sunday is what we're doing when we're doing World Communion, just like we did Easter sometime in the middle of summer. Isn't the day so much as the exact time is, as much as it is the observance of it. So, you got these little cups, and I know Kathy explained them to you. I'm hoping that against all odds, we'll be able to do these things without everybody going out with purple streaks down the front of their shirts or something. It's got two little peel-off pieces, in case you missed that, a clear one on the top that releases the wafer. And then after you get that out, you peel up, pull up the pink one, or the reddish one, and that gives you access to the juice. We got these from the Lutheran Church in Britain because I ordered some from the Methodist, and it came in and it said juice only, and I thought, oh, great. So we had all kinds of ideas, you know, cut up little pieces of bread and smash them flat. That didn't seem like it was real healthy. And so we hung over to the Lutheran Church, and secretary over there is a person we've known for quite a while, and she went back and found them and said, this is what we use, and I said, could you sell us about 100 of those? And she said, sure. So, but then on the way into town Friday, we thought, oh my gosh, Lutherans, what if these things have wine in them? We'll probably have a rebellion among in the ranks here. So we got in, and one of them seemed to be loose, and so Kathy opened it up and threw caution to the wind and tasted it, and it was grape juice, known in Methodist circles as the unfermented juice of the grape. So we're safe. Now some might not think this is much fun, but you know, if you want to have wine, that's your business, but we're known for not doing that in church. Okay, there is a really nice insert paper or page in the paper this week about the 3M plant. Outstanding PR for the plant, and aerial photograph. That's something to look at and be proud of, and it's nice that they got the recognition. And it makes a huge impact on a community like ours. A plant like that, also on with the unknown life expectancy of the coronavirus issues. They're a huge provider of equipment for that, so face masks primarily. Also in the paper, we were surprised to see the Pastor Appreciation Month notice, and we appreciate that. That's nice of you to do that, whoever did it. And I also thought it was kind of interesting that there were only six churches represented in that thing. It's kind of sure they have any news, I'm glad that somebody did that too. So anyway, that was very nice. And we appreciate, they should have a thing where the pastors could send a deal that we appreciate it in our church too. I see that a lot, but it's just one more reason why you're thoughtful people, and we enjoy that. Okay, birthdays, had any birthdays, question mark. And Kathy said, well, yeah, my sister Julie and my sister Rosalie have birthdays. Joanne, I thought you supposed to say Rosalie.
No, it's Joanne.
Well, I know Rosalie has a birthday sometime. Not this month. Joanne, okay, Joanne in Colorado. Julie lives over in Groton. All right, any other birthdays? Let's do happy birthday then. Good stuff. We'll turn to our call to worship and our hymn, Grace and Peace, Friends.
We're here at God's call to give thanks.
And our first hymn is number 630, Become to Us the Living Bread. Let's stand for that, please. They just kind of like to go free and do things that are a little just operate with a little freer spirit. In our parish at Milner Winer in Litcherwood, Litcherwood is primarily a Bohemian area, and neat experience. Those people were a lot more fun than some of the others, but, and I talked about that with the others as well, so. I too were probably as manageable as a hard ice scrapper, we say. It's kind of an interesting phrase, isn't it? Anyway, all that by way of beginning our prayer time. And when it just seems like, what can we do? We can do like Mother Teresa said, put ourselves in God, the hands of God, God's mercy, and listen to God's word in the depths of our hearts. Let's pray. Eternal God, we have said and have heard said often, well, at least we can pray, when actually maybe that's the first and foremost thing we can do. Maybe that's the strongest thing we can do. We can't solve huge problems on our own. If our whole town gave half or more of its money, its resources, its food, its outreach to the world outside, we probably wouldn't be able to make much difference even in one town. Or two or three. And so we pray. We pray for healing for those who have been ill, for those who are facing uncertain health issues, for those who love them who are afraid. We pray for people whose lives have literally, in terms of their wealth, their homes, their vehicles, we've lost it all. We've experienced so much damage that they can hardly even imagine ever getting dug out of it, in terms of debt and their own physical strength. So we pray for them that they might find strength. We pray for those around who can help with their presence and help with their building skills, their organizational skills, their gifts of money and time. So often we see pandemics and hurricanes and fires and floods and all these things as just one more news story in the midst of Hogan's Heroes and Bonanza and all those kinds of things that entertain us that we almost don't feel the reality of the tragic things. We do sometimes need escape, and these things provide that. May we not live in them, but rather find some rest in them and be able to be our people of strong belief, strong commitment, and immense generosity in a world of need. May we be
us into a family.
We pray that as you accept us as we are, we learn to accept others whose ways differ from our own. As we open our hearts to you, we pray that you lead us to open our hearts to others. We worship here without exclusion and rejoice without ceasing and continue in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
This morning, Art brought in a song, and he says, maybe you know this. And well, I didn't. I never played it before, but I didn't know this song. So I'm going to change the key, Art. I'm not going to do it in G. I'll do it in C. We'll see how that works. It's called I Shall Not Be Moved.
Jesus is the Savior, I shall not be moved.
River bottom feeders?
No, that was a different one.
Okay.
But Bishop Lewis was our bishop at the time, and he about fell off his chair. He thought that was pretty good. We had Mike Pointer, when he was bishop, had two little girls come up to him after, before the appointments, then too, I guess it was. And they said, so, part of your job, Bishop, is to move people, right? And he says, well, yeah, that's what I have to do. And she says, you got a rotten job. I said, we're friends, and we don't live very far apart, but you're moving our families to whole different places. We don't like it. So you have a rotten job. And they turned around and left. And he wrote about that. He says, well, sometimes it is. Sometimes it is. And then, like you said, also, sometimes you think you've done a good job and some of the churches don't. And some of the churches, they give you the rotten job. We jumped at the opportunity to leave Fargo and move to Milner, Winer, Lakewood, and eventually Sheldon. And I now sat in Fargo. And after church, one of the persons who I later, I had just discovered was one of my nemesis. Bishop Lewis said, you know, there was a, he said there was one guy in Illinois conference, Southern Illinois, who was just, he shot from the hip every time he opened his mouth. And he said he was in trouble so much and he got moved to smaller and smaller parishes. And one time he was talking with a friend and he said, what can they do to me? I'm already in whatever the town was. And appointment time came and the bishop read out the announcements and they had appointed this guy to a little tiny parish way back in the mountains or the hill country. And he allowed this anguished voice from the back of the room was heard to say, oh my God, I forgot about Piney Corners or whatever it was, you know. So, but we know now, a long time ahead. And one of the fun things about being retired and being here, I love this place. And one of the neat side things is, they say, are you open to being moved? And I said, no, why would I? I said, if you want to move me, you can try, but I'm not going. So, yeah, that's kind of a stack deck. I know how that's going to go, so it's kind of fun to be able to do those things. Okay, the scripture for today is Psalm 137, and the reading of that's actually going to show up someplace here before I'm done. But I'm not going to start out with it. About the third year, I was in seminary at the Methodist Theological School in Ohio. I mean, what could be more accurately named than that? You know, instead of St. John's Pontifical College, which was down the road from us, is a Catholic seminary. Methodist Theological School in Ohio. As clear as it could be. Anyway, well, this is my third year in seminary there. The decision was made to move our daily chapel service from our colonial style chapel, mostly white wood paneling, dark wood armrests on the pews, a dark wood trim on everything, royal purple, or not purple, kind of a deep red curtain up front. There's also a stage up front, but they had a curtain in front of it for chapel. And then the pulpit was up there, it was white wood and had the dark wood. It was beautiful, it was really a beautiful room. It had carpet about like that. We moved from there down to the basement of the library in the same building. Now the basement was concrete, gray, cold looking, with ceilings about 18 feet high. All it was concrete, up, down, above you, below you, around you. Heavy, heavy pillars. The pillars were probably this square, and there were a whole bunch of them. But they were far enough apart that we could set up a worship area, kind of a horseshoe shape, horseshoe with square corner shape. And the communion table was in the middle, and behind that was a very simple pulpit. And the idea was, I guess, that the move was made with the hope that the pure, simple surrounding would help those of us in the place focus on the reason we were there as opposed to admiring the comfort and warmth and relative luxury of the sumptuous colonial chapel. Some call it the catacombs, like a trip into the underground of cities where early Christians went to get away from those who killed them. I liked it down there. It was, you couldn't think about much else except what was going on in the center of our circle. We had a Quaker service one time where nobody said anything until someone felt moved to say something. Warren Hill, who was one of the few black students in the seminary at the time, got up and he said, you know, I've always felt welcomed by y'all. This has been a good experience. But he says, you know, I really wish that you would talk to me like you talk to each other. I mean, I don't always have to talk about Martin Luther King Jr. or all these other black heroes. Sometimes I like to talk about my kids or which tire should I buy for my car, like you guys talk about, or baseball or football. He says, I'm one of you. That was Nate. And it wouldn't have been said anywhere else. I said something one time, and I can't remember what it was, but one of the professors said, the service is getting long enough, and we should be out of here. So I wrapped it up pretty quick. We also held our preaching classes there. We had a little preaching cell, you might call them, 5-6 students in it. And we'd prepare a sermon, we'd deliver it, and then the class, rest of the group would critique it. And I happened to get the text on the resurrection of Jesus. It was kind of an unnerving time to get up in front of your classmates, but it was well worth it. During critique time, one of our group members, whose name was King Hannah, and his wife's name was Hannah. It was just kind of funny. Anyway, King said, Jack, I liked your sermon, but you make it sound like Christian faith depends on the resurrection. There was a loud noise from the back row. The professor had stood up, dropped his clipboard on the floor, and he said, well, King, doesn't it? I thought it was so cool. And then the professor proceeded to defend my sermon, which I should have been doing it, but he stood up and defended my sermon. I thought, whoa, how much better could it get? Well, I found out how much better, and later on he said, the essence of that sermon was good, but he said you could use a little more work on being a little less rigid or structured. Tell you what, he says, I'll give you a B in preaching for this semester if you agree to take the preaching section over again, otherwise I'm going to fail you and you'll have to. Well, that was an offer you couldn't refuse. He didn't even have a gun in his hand or anything. So I said, hey, I'll do that. Yeah, that was the best thing that could have happened because he said, just relax. There's nothing wrong with notes. Don't just stand there and read your notes. I was nervous as I was reading my notes. What a heady experience. We had communion every week in the chapel. One time, a few more people showed up than usual. And as the last one in line presented himself to receive the elements, from the juice poured into a small glass, I could see sitting up front, there were just a few little bubbles, kind of purpley bubbles, foamy stuff in the bottom. And Scott Wood was a year ahead of me in seminary, a celebrant that day. He looked at this fellow student right in the eyes and he said, drink ye all of this. The guy licked that thing out, you know. That was almost a commandment from God, you know, drink ye all of this. So he did. It was funny in a way, and yet at the same time, it was profound. It was saying, if we took time to reflect on it on our own, here, there, wherever we went, it was saying, when all is gone, lost, if you will, when our resources are at an end, God can work for good within us with the slightest resources we have. First time I've ever used that. I've always thought of that though, drinking all of this. And in our unusual communion circumstance, I guess that woke me up. I thought we ought to be reminded of that. God can work for good within us with the slightest resources we have in the world. first three verses of today's psalm are paraphrased in the modern rock opera Godspell, which reminds us that even when all seems lost and defeat is at hand, there is hope in the Spirit, which is holy and which lives wholly within us and around us all. The name Godspell, as God ends in the word spell, is contemporary for gospel, given to us with the words, "Drink ye all of this, that you might find hope and renewal." And the scripture paraphrased for today, at least the first few verses, Godspell speaks to us this way. On the willows there we hung up our lyres, for our captors there required of us songs, for our tormentors mirth. On the willows there we hung up our lyres, for our captors there required of us songs, for our tormentors mirth. Saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Sing us one of the songs of Zion. Come on, Israelites, sing a song of Zion. You're always so proud. They don't add all those words in there. They're there. And it ends with, but how can we sing? Sing the Lord's song in a foreign land. How can we sing in troubled times? With God's help, the presence of the Spirit, we can, in the midst of any awful time of separation and betrayal and pandemic and loss of loved ones and friendships and even hope sometimes, sing the Lord's song and live with renewed hope. Hymn is 707, Hymn of Promise. Let's stand and sing that. Please. get set up this time, open your personal communion bag. If you should have problems with these, raise your hand. Rod has some napkins, and he also has more cups. If something goes haywire, you need another cup. It's a whole new experience. Maybe I'm not trusting us all to be able to handle it as well as what I think we probably will, but it's going to be interesting. It's also it also fits in very much with the First Communion. Which is preceded with the prayer, "Hear us, merciful God, we most humbly ask you. And bless and sanctify here with your word and spirit these your gifts of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his passion, death, and resurrection, may be partakers of the divine nature through him who in the night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then after the meal, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said to them, drink all of this. Drink, eat all of this. For this is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you should drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us continue in prayer together. O God, we are unworthy to share this rite, but you are merciful and forgiving. As we share these elements, help us to renew our commitment to become more Christ-like. As usual, everyone is welcome to this table, because it's not our table or a table of any particular church, it's the table of our Lord, to which everyone is invited. Now, we're going to share the elements, peel back the transparent layer first, and liberate your wafer. This is a good little tool to use, and we don't usually have bread at communion for the tastiness of the bread, which is good because this stuff isn't going to win any prizes.
No.
But it's a neat alternative, neat opportunity. Through the journey of our lives, we confess that we have looked for our needs instead.
So you won't be here? Okay. What's in Sioux Falls?
South Dakota Chess Championship.
Oh. I suppose Michael's going too? Okay.
He's going to come down.
All right, well, good luck.
He wants me to, you know. Yeah. I mean, we don't...